Bhavesh asks, what should I do to be ego-free? And I can understand why Bhavesh is putting his question in such a language. Because all your training, upbringing, education has told you that to get anything, you have to do something. That to get anything, you have to do something, which is all right. I'll relate it to the question Arvind asked. Whenever something is outside of you, you surely have to do something to get it, right? Whenever something is there, then you have to go there. And what is there outside? The subject or the object? So in the world of objects, you always have to do something to fetch it. Are you getting it? So you are looking at HIDP just as you look at your other subjects. You're thinking that you need to do a lot, Bhavesh, to become ego-free. The truth is just the opposite. When we are talking about yourself, you don't have to do anything to get ego-free. Instead, you have to stop doing all that you are doing to get ego-free. Understand this. Many of you, I can see, are deeply in attention at this moment. They are just listening. They are actually not doing anything. They are just sitting silently with no movement of the body or of thought, and they are just listening. Listening is happening. They don't have to do anything. There are many others here who are doing something. Their bodies are fidgeting, their minds are wandering, and a lot of doing is happening. They cannot listen. They cannot listen. In the world of the self, doing is a big hindrance. It's a big problem. In the world of objects, doing helps you. In the world of the self, undoing helps you. Stop doing what you're doing. You don't have to do anything extra. You are already doing so much, and this doing is your curse. You cannot stop doing anything. I ask you, can you sit even for a minute doing nothing? Can you sit even for a minute doing nothing, totally action-free and totally thought-free, with no thought in your mind, doing just nothing? Remember, thought is a doing. It is so very impossible for us, and it is a result of all our education that we have been always taught to do something, do something. Our elders told us hard work is the key to success. So do something in order to get something. And this doing has become such an obsession with us that we cannot even sit 1 minute without doing anything. And so you're asking, what do I need to do to become ego-free? Ego is the name of this doing. So by further doing, would ego enhance or decrease? Yes. Ego is this doing itself. By doing even more, would ego increase or reduce? Increase. Stop doing what you are doing and see what you are doing. Can you, for a moment, look at your daily life from morning till evening and see what you keep doing, and see the game of ego in all that? And if a mind is diseased with ego, whatever it will do will be ego-ridden. Do you see this? Can this same ego-ridden mind do something more to get rid of the ego? No, it can't. It can only look at what it is already doing, understand what it's doing, and in this understanding, it becomes free of all the rubbish which is being done by it. Are you understanding this? This will be something a little new to you. You'll have to be attentive to understand. All your actions presently are the result of external influences. And action is doing, do you see this? Action is doing. Presently, as we are, our actions do not come from our understanding, our intelligence. They come from an external influence. And that itself is called ego. To be intelligent, but to act on an external influence, that is what is ego? To have your own free will, that is what is ego. So, how will I detect ego? What is the symptom of ego? How do I see ego? Where do I see ego? I can see ego only in all my doing, right? Because all my doing is happening as per the instructions of the external, the objects, family, society, media, corporations. They are the ones who are influencing me, and all my actions and thoughts are coming from their influence. This doing has to be understood. When I look clearly at what I do from morning till evening, I understand that I am not free, and my actions are hugely influenced by the external, by the objects. They are hugely influenced. When I see that all my doing is hugely influenced, then that doing reduces. It naturally, automatically reduces. You don't have to do anything extra. And in the reduction of this doing lies freedom from the ego. In the reduction of this doing lies freedom from the ego. Are you getting it? You see the linkage? This doing is all happening because of an external influence. And that itself is called ego. So in the reduction of this doing is freedom from the ego. Do you see this? It's quite straightforward. Not complex at all. It's actually very simple. Yes.
What is the difference between alter ego and super ego?
You are speaking the language of Freud. How many of you have heard of Freud? Freud. He was the most famous psychologist of the last century. In fact, his work was very, very path-breaking, right? Freud said that the human mind, that the human psyche has broadly three components. I'll pick up only that part of his work which pertains to your question. He said the biggest part is called id. And it's a totally unconscious part, we know nothing about it. It's a huge part of our psyche, the mind. And it remains unconscious. We know nothing about it, but obviously it affects our life, our actions, our behavior. Then he said there is something called the ego. And his use of the ego was not as direct as the context in which we have just used it. Then he said there is the ego. He said it is that part of the psyche, that part of the self, which you know to be there. And then he said there is something called the superego. Superego means that imagination of the self, that what it wants to be, that ideal in which it wants to cast itself. Are you getting it? Alter ego means I hold an image of myself. I hold an image of myself, and there is something who comes over and exactly completes the image that I have of myself. That he called as alter ego. The gap in all this Freudian psychoanalysis is that he never talks of anything beyond the ego. He says that the human mind is nothing but the ego, and that ego has three distinctions. The totally hidden one, which he calls as id, the conscious one, which he calls as ego, and the aspirational one, which he calls as superego. But he never sees that man can be free of ego. He says, whatsoever you do, you will always remain in one of these three states, which are all nothing but states of ego. Freud never said that it is possible to be free from ego. But your neighbor has just asked, sir, what do I do to be free from ego? Bhavesh asked that. Freud would have said, you can't do anything. But that's not really the truth. In observation of ego lies freedom from ego. In observation of the ego, in understanding of the ego, lies freedom from the ego. All right? Yes, next. Speak, and bring the questions closer to yourself. Do not let them be overly theoretical. Bring them to yourself.
Sir, what is the difference between ego and confidence?
Wonderful. What's your name?
Nitin Dixit.
Nitin. Nitin says, what is the difference between ego
and confidence?
Nitin, do you need confidence in front of your loved ones, say your mother or family members? Do you need to be confident in front of them? When you are naturally, freely at your home, do you require confidence? How many of you require confidence even in front of your parents? In your routine matters, not when you are making a demand or something. Do you need confidence? You don't, right? But you do need confidence when you are making a presentation in your HIDP sessions, right? Standing in front of an audience of 40, 50, then you need confidence, correct? Can you tell me why don't you need confidence at home, or why don't you need confidence standing in front of a mirror, but you do require confidence when facing an audience? If you understand this question, you'll understand what this thing called confidence is. Yes, tell me.
So we are familiar with our family members, but not the audience.
Correct. And what does that familiarity do?
Sir, familiarity means our parents trust on us.
Good. So you're not afraid of your parents, are you?
Yes.
Confidence is a clear indication of fear. You require confidence only when you are afraid. Now, when you are afraid, I ask you, what is better? Just the elimination of fear or bringing in confidence to face fear? What is superior? Elimination of fear itself. If fear is gone, there is no need of confidence. If fear is gone, there is no need of confidence. You are hesitant in front of an audience. Do you know why? Because your self-concept, your self-image comes from the audience itself. When the audience tells you, you are smart, you start believing that I am smart. And what is this process called? This process is called development of the ego. How? An external agent told you that you are smart, and you attached your I to that word smart. The other one told you, you are smart. And what did you start saying? I am smart. So this smartness is not coming out of your understanding. It is coming from the external party. Now, if the external party has given you this sense of being smart, it surely also can take back the smartness. Hence, you are afraid. Do you know why you are afraid in front of the public? Because you have no understanding of yourself. Your self-image comes from the eyes of others. Others tell you wonderful, you start believing you are wonderful. Others tell you you have done a dirty work and you start believing I have done a dirty work. Others tell you are successful. Others give you your goals. Others give you your religion. Others give you your name. Others give you your beliefs. Because everything comes from others, you're always afraid that the others can also take it back. You are afraid, standing on the podium, that the audience can take back their acceptance of me. That the audience may start saying that I am dull and stupid. And that makes you very, very afraid. Because you have given your control in the hands of others. And this is what is called ego. I am what others tell me. I am what situations dictate me. This is what is called ego. And ego, therefore, is fear. Will you remember this? Ego is fear. Ego comes from outside, and hence it is always afraid that the outside can take it back. What comes from the outside can also go back to the outside. Hence the ego is always afraid. And hence ego requires confidence. So confidence is nothing but a requirement of the ego. If where there is ego, there is fear. Where there is fear, to face that fear, you require some kind of confidence. Don't ask for confidence. Ask yourself why you are afraid. Don't seek confidence. Confidence is a fake thing that covers up your fear, that covers up the disease. And if you cover up the disease, you will never be cured. Don't cover up the disease. Try to understand where this fear comes from. And that would be wonderful. That is the function of an intelligent man. Yes? Do you see this?